many of what you would refer to as advanced capitalist countries, say Japan, US or the European countries, had precisely that throwaway culture because of considerable citizen action. Not only technology, because of regulation, community empowerment, people's participation, much greater consciousness, that throwaway culture has, to a large extent, been brought under control. I'll give you a very strange instance. You know, in the 60s, 70s, there was a lot of worry about the decline of birds of prey. Rachel Carson wrote about the bald eagle. In the 70s, there was concern about Shaheen falcon, which I think there they call the peregrine falcon. So all of you would have seen films of Denzel Washington and Angelina Jolie. So there's a film. I don't know if you recall it, The Bone Collector. Remarkable, Denzel Washington is on his back in the whole film, only he can only speak. And he solves a crime lying on his bed, of course. But in one of the scenes, they show a peregrine falcon flying off the window. The peregrine falcons come back to the skies of the United States because pesticide levels have gone down. I'm afraid India, China, Brazil, South Africa, Indonesia, Vietnam, precisely at the time when the West moved out of that, we moved in. There's a frightening book whose name I'm forgetting. It's a frightening book by Robin Jeffrey and Asa Doron. It's an Australian Israeli on India. And I forget the figure. The amount of waste produced by urban Indian has gone up some 80-fold in the last 20 years. 80-fold. So this mountain of garbage, I think it's an excellent example. So we look at advanced capitalist society, we can also pick up some of the positive elements that are there in it, such as a state which has the capacity to regulate and citizens who also have a level of consciousness. Your other point is extremely well taken. I think this is absolutely critical. One of the most remarkable books recently written was Carbon Democracy, in which Mitchell argues that the coming of oil is the big change. Oil is very fluid, and it has brought about a level of not just waste, but an exploitation, both of nature and labor, which is huge. So I think that's a very valid point, and it, again, please look carefully, precisely the things, and leave the United States out for a minute, which many of the advanced developed world has done. Particularly look at the Scandinavian countries, then as now, often regarded as exemplars. Now, we can't do all of the things they're doing. I'm not suggesting that. There's no model. You can't pick up something from A and fit it to B. But definitely, looking at cultures of prudence would be absolutely vital. The instance which Savesachi brings out beautifully in another essay, which I'm sure you know very well, The Tiger and the Honeybee, where he shows that in Simlipal, the Mayurbhanj hill kharias measure the productivity of the forest in terms of honey, the madhu bhandars, the taste of honey in the forest, the pollinator, whereas the forest department keeps counting the tigers, whether they do it right or wrong, I don't know. And you know, they look at the predator. And here in the forest department, so the tiger and people are separate. Whereas in the hill kharia view, deer among the people are the guardians of the madhu bhandar. So of course we have to respectfully learn from such cultures, but that may have to be combined with an understanding of these new technologies and approaches. So there's no one royal road. It'll have to be a sophisticated approach.
Thank you so much, sir. और इसी के साथ ना चाहते हुए भी हम आ गए हैं एक और बेहतरीन सेशन के अंत पर हम भी कुछ कर नहीं सकते, वक्त का दामन हमें थामे रखना है एंड वक्त के साथ चलना है. एंड इसलिए नाउ टू रिफ्लेक्ट द शेड्स ऑफ ऑनर, एस्टीम एंड जॉय, आई वुड लाइक टू रिक्वेस्ट मिस्टर अभिलाष खानिकर टू ग्रीट आवर गेस्ट ऑथर मिस्टर महेश रंगराजन विद द ब्यूटीफुल मोमेंटो, दिस विल बी फॉलोड बाय गिफ्ट टू आवर डिस्कशन फॉर द सेशन डॉक्टर मधु वर्मा एज वेल. And friends, let me again tell you, all the mementos presented by the Bhopal Literature and Art Festival has a picture of Vakratun, which translates to an elephant's trunk. It is a fascinating, expressive, and almost alien-like feature which offers endless opportunities for captivating pictures. With the fusion in nose and the upper lip, the elephant's trunk is the most versatile tool used for breathing, smelling, touching, grasping, and producing certain sounds. Thank you so much, everyone. Please give a big hand to them.
The man who headed the elephant task force got this one. Yes, definitely.
Moving on. The next session that we have scheduled here is the future of work. And I would request all of you to please be seated because this is again going to be an interesting session. And the guest author and the guest speaker for this session is Mr. Elwin Didar Singh. मैं चाहूँगा कि हम कालियों के साथ उनका स्वागत करें स्टेज पर. And he will be in conversation with Anurag Srivastava, Sanjeev Shriya, and Shabri Nair. मैं चाहूंगा हमारे जितने भी गेस्ट हैं वो स्टेज पे आके अपने स्थान ग्रहण करें. एंड अगेन बिफोर मूविंग ऑन लेट मी ब्रीफ यू अबाउट आवर गेस्ट स्पीकर्स एंड द मॉडरेटर्स. Starting with Dr. Elvin Didar Singh. He is an author and civil servant who served as the Secretary to Government of India from 2009 to 2011 and as Secretary General to FICCI, that is Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, from 2012 to 2017. Dr. Singh is presently Senior Fellow, Delhi Policy Group and Advisor, Bridge India, London. As our first discussion for the day, we have Mr. Anurag Srivastava. He is an innovator, mentor, and a leader. He's also the founder and CEO at Netlink. And he has over 25 years of experience in the information technology industry, including building and leading globally distributed technology teams in the US, Australia, Europe, and Asia. As the second discussion for the day, we have Mr. Sanjeev Shriya. He is an IT entrepreneur who is the founder of Smart Chip, a biometrics, smart card and digital securities company. He has spearheaded the smart card and biometric movements in India and has helped shaping policy in these areas. He is also the president of Smart Card Forum of India. Moving on, the third discussion we have Shabari Nair. He's a migration policy specialist in the International Labour Organization. And I would request our guest author and guest speakers and the moderators to please unveil their conversation, and we must support them with a huge round of applause and a big hand.
Okay, thank you very much. I have a small presentation which you just go through in just 10 minutes. It'll set the stage for what we are trying to do and say out here. Basically, we're going to talk about the future of work. And in this, I want you to just look at this and just read this very carefully. The factory of the future will have only two employees, a man and a dog. The man will be there to feed the dog. The dog will be there to keep the man from touching the equipment. This was written by Warren Bennis in 1991, long, long time ago. He's predicting the future of the factory or the future of work in a manner which is devastating. This is to scare you people that in the future, it'll be complete automation and therefore there will be no place for human beings, so to speak. Now, why are we talking of this? Because of the global trends. I'm not going to get into these details, but basically global trends today are those there's a deglobalization and globalization taking place on the one side. There is demographics, that is, there's a whole change in the kinds of societies and populations around the world. And there is technology, 3D printing and artificial intelligence and all that which is happening. So all these three at a global level are impacting the future of work. Now, what is this future going to be for India and all our countries? The biggest problem that you have to understand is the two revolutions of infotech and biotech will merge. Infotech and biotech will become one. In other words, you may have human beings like you and me who will be walking around with chips which are implanted in us. It sounds scary, but that is what the future actually holds. In this context, all this artificial intelligence, big data algorithms, bioengineering, all this will tremendously impact jobs. And if it impacts jobs, you're really going to have to look at not just jobs, but actually of humans themselves. What are we going to manage? How are we going to manage this change scenario? In that, if you look at the global perspective, this is just for your information. 4 years ago, the West started talking about it. America, Europe, USA, World Economic Forum, they took out many reports to say there'll be tremendous loss of jobs. 60% of jobs in OECD countries would be gone. And 40% in OECD countries and 60% in developing countries like India and China would be finished. The same world situation now is being looked at a little differently. They're saying, yes, it will happen, but it will happen in a graded manner. There will be different loss of jobs in developing countries. and different loss of jobs in OECD countries. The question is really that everything can be automated, but is it being automated? That is a question we have to ask, and that is what our experts here will tell you about. It's all about labor arbitrage. Places like India and China have a tremendous labor arbitrage, so maybe we will not automate as quickly as, say, USA or Europe or England. The ILO set up a global commission on the future of work. This was headed by, the co-chair was President Cyril Ramaphosa of South Africa, and you can see that we have two Indian commissioners, there are 26 of us on this global commission. Basically, what the global commission did was this. It said that for the future of work, you must have a human-centered approach. And for a human-centered approach, you must increase investment in people's capabilities, in capabilities of institutions that deal with work, and finally increase investment in decent and sustainable work. Are we doing this? For India, I've just put out here what is the recommendations of the Global Commission and where does it fit with India. They talked about universal entitlement for lifelong learning. All you think are youngsters here. You will have to think of lifetime learning, not just going to college once for 2 years or 3 years or 5 years. In India, we are having a massive skills initiative. We have to link with this. They talk of long life or lifelong universal social protection. In other words, if you lose your job, how are you going to manage on a day-to-day basis? So social security. In India, in government, we are actually looking at social security, universal minimum wages, health insurance schemes, NAREGA. All of this is to provide basic money for individuals at all levels to be able to manage. Revitalizing collective representation, and finally, long-term sustainable investment in areas where you have like care economy, green economy, rural economy, where jobs actually can be created for the future. If you look at India, our biggest issues are the informal sector, jobless growth, and the skills deficit. So what is the informal sector? I won't get into details, but I think you're all aware, India has 92% of its jobs in the informal sector. All these fancy jobs that you and I have are only 8% of the jobs. Balance is actually that of the Rera Wala outside, or the fellow selling vegetables, or somebody selling tea outside. Those are the informal jobs. It's a major problem for India. It doesn't exist in the West, but it exists in India. We have jobless growth. What is happening in the past few years, even though manufacturing has gone up, Make in India is happening, but actually you're losing jobs. For every new job being, or every new work being produced, more productivity, but lesser of jobs. So this is becoming a major issue for India, and therefore the social security net has to be thought of. And finally, the skills deficit. Are we being able to find the right type of people for the right type of jobs coming up? And for that, you need a massive skilling program. Finally, if you look at the global situation, you will find that the future of job has four types of basic jobs that will be there in the future. Creative jobs, skilled jobs, rote jobs, and robotic jobs. The only one that you and me can dream of or think of is creative jobs. That is all that will last. In the future, if you're in any of the other three, you have a chance of losing your job, so you have to go here. And this is a matrix that was done for 2022. That 9% will be deployed in new jobs, 37% jobs will be radically changed, and 54% may lose their jobs. This is the situation which is emerging for the future, and we all have to really think about it, because for 10 jobs created, 100 jobs are taken away by artificial intelligence. This is what Economic Times wrote just this year. It's a massive situation which is happening around the world. It is also happening in India, and we have to be careful about what we do. My final thoughts on this are that why do we need jobs? It's not just a question of money, it's a question of dignity. And on that last score of dignity, how do we manage to combine artificial intelligence and the need of humans to be involved in work? So thank you very much for that. This is just an introduction. I now request the others to kindly give their views in this discussion. Thank you very much.
No?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, okay, you're working. So, first of all, we have some very important people here, Mr. Didar Singh, Sanjeev, and Shabri Nair. And I read a little bit about what they have written and what they have gone through. It was very interesting because my background is very different. I was the picture that he showed in 91, because that's when I graduated from my bachelor's, and I was sitting in front of a dog, thinking, what will I do with my mechanical engineering degree? And I got a job in one of the automotive companies, and once they started to put us in training, it was basically going in sweaty places and trying to, you know, assemble certain things just to learn, which made me feel very insecure. And I didn't know anything about how to use computers when I was doing my bachelor's. And suddenly one of the managers came into that shop floor and said, I'm looking for some people who may be interested in learning programming. And I raised my hand without knowing what programming meant. So it was very interesting. And when you pointed out that people should learn something new, upgrade their skills to look for opportunities, I think that is important. And I think that has been historical, not just now. In fact, when I was a child, I also heard from my parents that when the gas cylinders came at home, people started complaining at home that this is not going to create, you know, it's going to create a lot of issues. Some servants or cooks, they will lose their jobs. Then similarly, when you talk about farming, when tractors came, then people started to feel bad that, you know, the labor that is needed on farms, they will not be having jobs. But then it took, you know, the maturity over a period of time, and people also got jobs because they started driving tractors, doing the plowing, seeding, you know, and all those activities changed and employment suddenly increased. So similarly, if you really see from time to time, there are always needs to do automation, bring new ideas, bring innovation, bring new machines. And then over a period of time, in last 10, 15 years, suddenly there's more development happening on how to write better systems, how to write better programs, how to create better automated machineries. And now even artificial intelligence, machine learning, deep learning, all of these things are very important. So when we started our IT company also, we were doing simple programming using COBOL and Oracle and those things. And over a period of time, we have seen that there is a lot of changes. And if you don't do it, if you don't train your workforce, if you don't bring people from outside who may not have exact background, but if you don't train them, it becomes very difficult. So for industries, we are IT industry, we are serving multiple industries outside. But for those industries also, to create value in the business, they have to train people. So as an employer, I think that is very important that you create a culture where it is available for senior people or people who have invented something to train other people, coach other people, bring in people who are smart. They may not be very clear on what you're doing, but they're very smart. Bring them in, they're innovative, they can bring some new ideas. They can actually help you solve the problem for the business. They can actually create more value for the businesses. So all those things are very important. So there is a need for further employment. Actually, if you see, even with automation, artificial intelligence, machine learning, it is not just learning about those pieces, but also people who can bring some smartness, which is domain-specific smartness. So I've seen that there is always a risk that is predicted. And the prediction of risk related to automation actually also predicts that there's going to be unemployment. But if you see, I've seen some reports in India at least, in last 10 years or so, especially 5 years more often, there is a huge increment in the job employment. And the reason for that is, if you really see the way industries are using this automation, the way they are training people, the way they are creating the value for the businesses, it also creates a lot of employment around it. For example, in India, 5 years ago or 7 years ago, we would not have thought of getting the food delivered to our kids. Suddenly, there's a new application being created for food delivery, and now there are a ton of people there. Hundreds of thousands of people are delivering food. That's the new employment created. And these people also have the intention of learning better and becoming maybe supervisors in these industries or doing something better. Similarly, you see the Uber, you know, and Ola. I think there is a lot of employment being created because of the automation, because of artificial intelligence that is being put into these products. So I think all those things are very important. And the key things here are, which I believe is, the risk predictions and actual realization depends on how you're implementing these things. What is the behavior? Are you changing the behavior of the people? Are you changing the culture of the organization? Are you providing more training, development of the workforce? Are you actually tying up with engineering colleges or normal colleges, whatever colleges, to actually working with them and creating a very specific curriculum and training facilities for them? I think industries will have to do that. I don't know if government can play a role. Maybe government can give some taxation, lack of taxation, or something they can do in the policy which allows these industries to not pay that much tax when they are investing into the learning of people, employees, or even making investment in innovation, coming up with new products. I think that might be helpful, but that education is extremely important. And then at the end of the day, if companies are doing the automation, not just to cut the cost, but they're doing the automation to grow the business, I think that is the most important thing. I've seen many companies who are just trying to cut corners. They're just trying to cut the cost in the organization, which helps you short term, but gives you profitability for maybe a year or 2 years, but then you lose the volume because there's so much competition. So you have to be a little more aggressive in doing things that will actually help you increase the volume. So those are the kind of things. And I know I can keep on speaking on this thing, but this is what I wanted to communicate, that
thank you so much.
Things are very important. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Anurag. You get what private sector can do and must do in this area. May I request Sanjeev, would you like to share your
views? I would like the discussions to be sitting there. And sure. If there is no video for this thing, so I think that makes much of a difference.
Well, so seems to be the day of dogs. So I'll give you a story about dogs. So, you know, there's a very famous picture, just like Alvin, you showed. It's about a dog on the other side of the internet. So, and the picture says, I don't have a copy here, but the title is that on the internet, anybody on the other side could be a dog. Because, you know, you are dealing with people whose identity is not known. And that's where I come from. I come from the world of identity. So my job is to give identity to people, whether they are physically available or they are remotely present in transactions. The other similarity with Anurag's story is that he talked about training and retraining. So, you know, by education, I'm a chartered accountant, but never practiced accounting for a day in my life. And now I run a technology company giving identity and digital security and artificial intelligence. So, you know, the topic of change and retraining is even for entrepreneurs and not only for employees. So that these are the two statements. Now, I mean, you know, typically the topic here is that will technology take away jobs and what do we do about them, in short.
Yes.
But the question then is that why do we embrace technology? And can we do without it? All of us are, you know, hung up on smartphones, despite the fact that lots of people tell us that, you know, using smartphone is bad for eyes, it's bad for concentration. It doesn't let you do your day-to-day jobs because you're busy on social media. But the fact is that technology and development is a one-way street. So if it's a one-way street, let's not lament about it. Let's do something about it. Because, you know, obviously, as Anurag pointed out, and you took away two of my examples that I had thought, that's the penalty of speaking after, you know, another speaker. So Swiggy and Uber are two examples, but I'll give you another example. What about rural BPOs? So one big problem is that urbanization, people coming up Delhi, you know, I'm from Delhi. Every day we have new people coming into Delhi because from where they are, they don't have jobs in the area they're migrating from. But technology allows you to have a BPO far away in the hinterland. Prevents urbanization. So as Anurag pointed out, you know, technology probably took away some jobs, but it created an opportunity
in an environment that could not be possible without technology. And because we can deliver identity and that person is not a dog on the other side of the rural BPO, that transaction can then be delivered sitting closer home in an environment where other job opportunities are not present, and facing, you know, saving us from carbon footprint. There was a conversation in the previous panel about carbon footprint and environment, because they are able to deliver those kind of services that necessarily earlier would have meant migration to urban cities. So, I mean, whether it is artificial intelligence, whether it is object recognition, whether it is other kinds of, you know, invasion of technology, as these slides would seem to kind of convey fear against. The fact is that we can't live without it, so we have to find an answer for it. And I guess that, you know, once we accept it, we will do more about it. So if we accept the fact that there will be an invasion of technology, means we need to get trained, we need to get retrained, and therefore, you know, let's do something about it.
Thank you, you're absolutely right, Sanjeev. On that note, let us switch to ILO, the International Labour Organization of the United Nations. We have with us Shabri here, who's an ILO specialist in migration and future of work. So let's hear what he has to say.
Thank you. Good afternoon. You know, while listening to Anurag and Sanjeev, I'm thinking about how I can keep this more in terms of our own personal lives, in terms of conversations that we should have that touch on workers' lives. When we talk about the future of work, the first thing that everybody talks about is skills. We all need skills. I mean, all of you, in some way or the other, have some skills. That's the reason why you have been invited here to speak at the session, or in terms of the contributions that you have for the economy. The first skill that we talk about is what? Language. Is language a skill in your opinion? Yes, absolutely. You know, my father, I come from Kerala, a small village in Kerala. My father migrated to Mumbai in 65 at the age of 15. And when he migrated to Bombay, he would always tell me, all roads in Kerala those days led to Bombay. And all roads in Bombay led to Sahar International Airport. Because that's the migration idea, right? So when he landed in Bombay, I mean, you already know about the situation in South India and how challenging it is for us to speak in Hindi, right? So when he landed in Bombay, his older brother was already there, told him, Bhaiya, dekho, you need to know in Bombay only two words. Malum nahi. Anybody asks you anything, you tell them malum nahi. So my father would always, has anybody traveled on a local train in Bombay? Yeah? It's very interesting. So he was going from Andheri to Bandra, which is about 10 stops in between, 10, 15 stops in between. And he was always a guy who's hanging out through the edge, you know, the end of the compartment. So at every stop, somebody will ask him, hey, utarne ka hai kya? Malum nahi. Language skills, skills in general, is a part of lifelong learning. And this is what Didar Singh was talking about in terms of investing in people. How do we invest in people? What are the elements that we want to look at when we talk about investment in people, right? Take, for instance, the issue of, well, when we talk about jobs, you know, Anurag and Sanjeev will talk about recruiting people. Recruiting people in India, paisa lagta hai bhai saab, to recruit people in India. You know, in some countries they say, for recruitment, they say money is over the table. In some countries they say money is under the table. In some countries they say money includes the table. So how does corruption fit in? And how does transparency fit in the overall scheme of recruitment for work and in terms of the overall future of work? Take, for instance, wages. This is an issue of investment in institutions. Wages are such a broad and sensitive topic. One of the issues that we will constantly hear about in the current landscape in India is about minimum wages. Should there be such a thing as a minimum wage, right? If there is none, how are we going to actually make sure that people who are working for the right job get the right wage? Equal pay for equal value between male and female, and all of those issues that come into picture here. In the context of along these wages, I remember I was sitting in a small village in Nepal, in the south of Nepal, in a district called Sarlahi, which is in the Madhesi region, with a group of Nepalese who had come from Saudi Arabia, Bahrain, and Qatar. sitting with them and asking them, Bhaiya, you tell me what work you did and how much you got. And everybody told me 300 riyals, 500 riyals painter, 600 riyals electrician, 200 riyals carpenter. They went like that. The last guy said, sir, 1000 riyals driver. So the first guy who said 300 riyals painter, he looked at him and said, yaar, tune toh Qatar ko loot liya? For 1000 riyals. 1000 riyals is what? About 29,000, 30,000 rupees. 30,000 rupees. He thinks, the guy earning 300 riyals thinks, that the guy who earns 1000 riyals, usne toh Qatar ko loot liya. So what aspect of wages do we want to keep in mind? I'll conclude with two final examples. Every time when we talk about the issue of investing in decent work, we have to keep in mind the gender lens. It's something that we lose out. You know, a friend of mine who grew up in Japan, Japan, as you know, has one of the strongest passports. You can travel to almost any country in the world without a visa. She now works, this Japanese friend of mine works in the UN in Delhi. And she said, it was only after I came to Delhi that I realized how difficult it was to get a visa for Indians. Or to organize a conference in India, a regional conference, and how difficult it was for a Bangladeshi or a Pakistani or a Sri Lankan to get a visa to come to India, right? So she tells me that is exactly how it is, because she grew up thinking that all people can travel easily. Similarly, as men, we automatically think that that is the norm. We need to change that sort of thinking if we want an effective future of work. My final example is more with regards to institutions. You know, there is no future of work without a broad whole of government setup. It's not about one institution or the other. I know at one point, Mr. Didar Singh was Secretary of the Ministry of Overseas Indian Affairs. Similarly, right now, there is no more Ministry of Overseas Indian Affairs. It is led by Ministry of External Affairs. But isn't migration, which is the topic that I deal with, also something that applies to Ministry of Home Affairs, Ministry of Justice and Law, Ministry of Skills Development, Ministry of Women and Child Affairs? You know, take any of these ministries. But is there a whole of government approach in dealing with an issue? Only then can we have a future of work that is effective. Otherwise, as one government representative told me, there's no whole of government approach, there is only whole in government approach. Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you very much. You heard all the panelists here give their views. I think before I open it up to your comments, I'll just ask any of the panelists, would you like to ask any other panelist any question or any comment? I'll just mention one thing. I'd rather ask you, Anurag. You were talking about how in the past there have been similar issues, like in agriculture, tractors came and they were replaced by you know, more jobs actually coming. You know, there is a slight difference this time, and we should realize that little difference, because this Luddite's problem has always been there. You know, they said when the looms would come, they would take away all the jobs of the weavers and whatever. So it's an old issue. The difference now from all the earlier times is that now the low skill is not what is going to be replaced, it's the high skill. It's a very, very major difference. Earlier, the low skill would be replaced, one tractor fellow would do another tractor fellow's job, or the farmer would now start driving the tractor, but not anymore. Now it's going to be your kind of jobs. If artificial intelligence takes away a job of a CEO in a company, who is going to replace that? Is really the question that you need to look at.
No, actually, the difference between what happened 40 years ago or 50 years ago versus now is also because of not having enough upgrade in the education systems. I think that's the concern. Even 5 years ago, I started to hear almost everywhere in any country I visited that they're sending their kids to robotics classes because they want kids to learn it, right? And in India, people are talking about it, but there's a very small percentage of parents who are already attached to these type of things. They have started to focus on those. So why there's a slowness in adopting to something which is going to change the future of the kids, right? Or it is important for those kids to learn something which is going to help them much faster. So that's the point I'm making. I'm not making the point across the labor that is out there, but it's more related to, because almost in villages, kids are going
in India, in a country like India.
But I would say, to comment on your question first on the threshold, that find the fact that the tractor displays the lower skilled job, as you said, and potentially the risk is on higher skilled or let's say more senior people. I would say they are not bigger or smaller problems, they're both problems. But if the people who are in higher skilled roles, their jobs are threatened to be replaced, they have, I would say, more resources at their help. First of all, their own comprehension and their resources and their ability to deal with that change would be somewhat better.
You're right.
So if I, as a CEO, my job is threatened, you see, I have a loyal friend, and I keep on telling him that, boss, tumhara job jaane wala hai, kyunki artificial intelligence mein 80% of your job will be taken away. Wo keh raha bhi nahi hoga. Maine kaha bhai kaise nahi hoga, main tumko samjhata hu. But the fact is that now that he understands, he needs to understand what he needs to do in order to prevent his job being threatened. So I would say the problem is not smaller or bigger, it's a different problem. I appreciate that point. But the answer is that we have to embrace the problem and we have to work towards it.
Shabri, when I hear terms like artificial intelligence, I'm thinking about that domestic worker at home. There was a time, and I think Vidar Singh sir is the person who remembers this much more clearly than I do. There was a time when a government representative in Delhi once told me, a few years back, told me, you know, Shabri, today's India is not about the ABCDs. Sir, ABCD kya hota hai? ABCD, A for IR, B for butler, C for chaprasi, and D for driver. Today's India is about the engineers, the doctors, the accountants, the lawyers. Now, these are the kind of people we're talking about. Look at this. This is, you know, people like Anurag is the pride of India, you know, the diaspora that we always want to look at, right? But at the same time, I'm struck with the fact that that is still such a small portion of our country. We have a population of 1.3 billion. Out of this 1.3 billion, close to 30 million are overseas. And out of these 30 million, close to 9 million are in the Gulf. What kind of jobs do you think they're majorly doing? And do you think they're thinking about artificial intelligence? Do you think the people, do you think the companies in the Middle East are thinking about artificial intelligence or want that guy to carry bricks from one side to the other side to ensure that that constructions, that stadium is constructed for the Qatar 2022 World Cup? So that's the conversations that we need to intertwine to make sure that anything along these lines, which is very important, what Anurag and Sanjeev say is very important about artificial intelligence, robotics, automation, and so on, very important. However, how do we bring a human face to it? How do we make sure that there is a human-centered approach in the thinking on these lines?
Excellent. So that takes us back to the ILO report and human-centered approach. Let's open it up for anybody who has comments or any question that they'd like to ask. The gentleman up there.
Can I get the mic? Don't you think there is a big gap between demand and supply and the kind of demand and supply? And we only specifically focus on high skill area like artificial intelligence and IoT and things like that? What about the general cross section? Because everybody wants to become doctor, everybody wants to become engineer. Is that the case in Indian scenario?
Yeah. In fact, today the vocational jobs earn more than, you know, BCom pass. So the fact is that there is a mismatch of demand and supply and aspirations. But you know, ultimately this is a open market, and frankly, if people who want to graduate and turn to accountants whose jobs actually will be most threatened or earlier threatened than having drivers and carpenters replaced, that's a question for them to answer. It's very difficult for anybody else to answer the aspirations of somebody else.
I believe we can afford two more questions if the answer is complete.
Just wanted to add very quickly there also that one thing I see lacking in the education system is we are teaching people exactly, whether it's a technical thing or economical thing or law, we are not telling them exactly how it affects the business. Giving domain knowledge of the business is going to create a lot of opportunities for people who are graduating.
Anji, we'll take two.
Hello.
So
yeah.
We'll take somebody
else. Full talk. I can't resist myself
sure,
to ask a question. Okay. Thank you. Sir, I have a question which will, I guess, raise the ears of our anchor as well. So, recently I have read that one of the IITian has launched a machine which can replace the work of anchors, public speaker, or a similar field. So, will it be possible? Can you please explain that? Thank you.
Please, him. Absolutely. No, but as Shabri was just mentioning, many of the jobs are really very good. The same IITian entrepreneurs or innovation, they have found a way to clean drains. So people don't have to go into drains to clean them, but they have machines that can actually clean that drain. So lots of good things are happening. Yes, Anji.
I'm only saying the lighter when he is doing another job.
Thank you so much, sir.
Anji.
Jobs pe baat ho rahi hai. तो एक प्रॉब्लम एक चीज़ जो है जो हर समस्या की अगर हम भारत की बात करें विश्व की भी और भारत की खास तौर से तो जो प्रॉब्लम मैं समझता हूँ कि जितनी भी समस्याएं बाहर अभी जो बाहर अनरेस्ट चल रहा है और अभी जिस टॉपिक्स पे हम बात कर रहे हैं इससे पहले और अभी भी तो जो समस्या है इन उसके सारे जो रूट कॉज जो है वो मैं समझता हूँ ऐसा मेरा मानना है कि पॉपुलेशन जो है इस जिस तरह से इंडिया में अभी भी उस पर कोई काम नहीं हो रहा है कंट्रोल के लिए तो इस इशू को हम किसी भी डिस्कशन में क्यों इग्नोर करते हैं या क्यों नहीं इस पर बात करते हैं कि पॉपुलेशन को कंट्रोल कैसे किया जाए जो कि दरअसल इन सारी समस्याओं को पैदा कर रही है।
आपने बहुत अच्छी चीज बोली है बिल्कुल ठीक चीज बोली है तो आंसर खाली एक ये दूं कि जो हमारी पॉपुलेशन है वो है अब उसके अंदर हम जिनको देखना है कि कैसे हम जॉब प्रोवाइड करें कैसे हम लोगों को एडजस्ट करें कैसे लोगों को प्रिपेयर करें फ्यूचर के लिए तो आज के जैसा सेशन है और पहले वाला भी जो सेशन था जो एनवायरनमेंट के ऊपर हुआ उसके ऊपर हम क्या बोलने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं हम खाली ये बोलने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं कि हमको सस्टेनेबल सॉल्यूशंस चाहिए कि किसी तरह से ये जो प्रॉब्लम हमारे दिमाग के ऊपर आ रहा है और हमारे हमारे पूरे समाज के ऊपर आ रहा है इसको हम कैसे सस्टेन करें कि हमारी नौकरियाँ और हमारे लोग फ्यूचर में भी काम कर सकें फ्यूचर में रह सकें और उनको कुछ मिले इस काम के अंदर तो ये इशू है और उसको हम डिफरेंटली एडजस्ट करने की कोशिश कर रहे हैं
सर एक तरफ जो है हम कहीं तो जाके उस चीज को चेक करें ताकि वो जो प्रॉब्लम है वो कहीं तो स्टॉप हो कहीं तो जाके उसको
बिल्कुल आप ठीक बोल रहे हैं लेट्स टॉक आफ्टर दिस सेशन मैं आपसे आई विल गिव यू द एग्जांपल ऑफ चाइना एंड वी कैन डिस्कस इट हां जी एनी अदर क्वेश्चन लास्ट क्वेश्चन
आई एम ग्लैड टू अटेंड योर सेशन I'm a BCom student in the first year from Bhopal School of Social Sciences. I have just one question. Sir, since I saw last year, when I was giving my 12th examination, there was a subject called the Business Studies. And from last 2 years in that Business Studies, there was nothing as such for us, the young generation, because we want the jobs and like we have to graduate and we have to get job, good how, good earn good money. So there was no such thing as how to work effectively and efficiently whenever we got graduated or we got in any form. So do you think that the Indian education system requires to teach the younger generation how to become the entrepreneurs and to become the new businessmen in the future, which is very much required?
Bilkul, innovate to the lady. The last question and we'll answer both these things together.
Yes,
all
sir.
Four of us, anybody can answer.
Since I'm the only lady asking, I'll take the privilege of sitting and asking the question. I think he's more or less stolen my question. While we all are deliberating on technology, how technology is impairing, sort of proving a roadblock to the concept of future of work. But my question really is it really begin at technology? The role of our educators and academicians and the way our teaching system is, don't you think that it begins much, much there and, the way our students are being dealt with, our curriculums, or is it just about technology?
Okay, thank you. Both the questions are on education. Would you like to comment?
Well, thanks so much, and I'm glad that this is how we are going to conclude it. Here's the thing about work. We talk about work, we're talking about lifelong learning. We're talking about something that has started as a result of how it was when you first went to primary school, right? We need
need to keep that in mind. You know how, why in India do we stress on upbringing? Because even at home, what we are taught contributes to how we are as individuals in our professional life. Right? So let's keep that in mind. Therefore, it is about home to school. It's about school to work. It's about work to training. It's about job to job, moving from one job to another. It's about job to retirement. That is the perspective of lifelong learning that we need to bring in. So therefore, can we then, I'm not going to talk about the educational system in our country, rather than talk about how can we ensure that the educational system in our country includes soft skills, includes skills which includes communication, right? A personality development. Focus on those elements, because when you come for a United Nations interview, they will not talk to you about subject matter, because that ends in the written exam. In the exam, in the interview, it's personality. And who you are as an individual and what you bring to the United Nations is what is more important there.
Any of you would like to comment?
Yeah, and actually to answer your question, you know, fine, you can lament about the education system, but I think if we are motivated, that there's a lot to learn, and you build technology to let you learn. You go to YouTube, Khan Academy, I mean, there's material, there's enough content out there. So fine, a teacher ne nahi padhaya, koi baat nahi. Aapko zarurat hai, aap smartphone pe kholiye, you'll be trained, spend time on it rather than doing social media, and you'll be, you know, you'll have a lot of skills.
Okay, just a final point, and in answer to your question,
there's a need to have a paradigm shift from making only graduation or degree to the life, how to face the life. That is outcome-based approach of the entire system. And the outcome is a very dynamic scenario. Second point you said about the Swayam, I am a producer in the Swayam. I have produced number of content areas in that.
Excellent.
In the technology area as well as instruction system designs. I have been involved in this kind of work, and one of the most important things, we have to prepare students for facing the life, not for any degree. Maybe a degree is only a means to it, but preparing for life is something beyond that.
So we have talked a lot about machines or I'm just going to talk about it.